what should be the pace of change, who's comfortable with it, who's uncomfortable, what sense of loss do people experience with change, how do they react to it, how do they respond to it, how do you build bridges between those who want one pace and those who want another. Radical change essentially posits there's an imperative, a moral imperative sometimes, that I'm responding to. And that moral imperative, more than just a moral concern, makes it impossible for me to compromise. The advantages, clarity, black and white, move on, do what you think is right. The disadvantages, polarization, division, not knowing what the dialogue, if any, will look like. That leads us to another piece of change, the social conditioning. Social conditioning takes longer. When they see something they're not used to, they're suspicious of it. And so the process of change with social conditioning is to actually put a personal face on the change, whoever is epitomized by that change. What the Talmud might call being dash bi'iro, being a person who is well-trodden in your city, a person who people know, but applied on the grander scale of mass movements. The advantages, beautiful. People actually change. People actually grow. The disadvantage, if you have to rely on the personal every single time, well then who's to say that the person who they meet doesn't just become the exception and the rule can never actually get started. Adaptive change comes in layers and in levels. And sometimes for every step forward, you have two steps back. On the eve of the Civil War, the rabbi of B'nai Jeshurun, Rabbi Morris Rafal, gave a essentially pro-slavery sermon describing how, while he's no friend to slavery in the abstract, what he thinks really matters is the middle ground, which is slavery is not itself an ill. The way that slavery is practiced is an ill. This was a worldly person who was worried about the anti-Semitism of abolitionists, who actually said, because the Torah allows slavery, it can't possibly be something that we should have to stamp out, but rather we should try to condition the way it's done. Rabbi David Einhorn in Baltimore took him to task. A false promised land. The Torah allowing slavery is not the ceiling, it's the floor. It's offering moral objectives and moral qualifications in a moment in history where there were none. The disadvantages are that you have to work within a system that sometimes can be ugly, and moreover, sometimes what comes out of that system is false promised lands. Pretending to people that some movement is enough or some progress is enough, and then the others fighting that it should never be enough. Ultimately, what the advantage of adaptive change should be, you actually never give up, that you realize that it's stages and that you work with what you have, using your double vision in order to move people in a direction, taking into account their real concerns.